One second, I'm going to try again. There you go.
This is Carlos. I'm the founder and CEO at Product School. Today, we have a really awesome guest on the podcast. Her name is Amanda Rottier, and she's the Senior Vice President of Product at CNN. Welcome, Amanda.
Welcome. Thanks. Thanks for having me.
It's funny to have someone from CNN now on the other side of camera. Although I guess that as SVP of Product, you're probably also behind the camera.
Yes, always behind the camera. This is probably the first time I've been on camera, actually.
So for people, just to learn a bit more about yourself from the very top, like what do you do as an SVP of product at CNN?
Sure. Yeah. So my role within CNN is I am the main product owner for all of CNN's digital products. So our digital products are what you would imagine, our website, which is the number one news website in the world. Our mobile apps, our connected TV devices, so everything from our Apple TV and Roku. And then we also have our content platform, our CMS, which we call Stellar. And we support other sites like CNN Espanol and CNN Arabic as well. So a really broad suite of digital products. My role is to manage the product and design teams within CNN that essentially work with the engineers to build that product. And I sit on the leadership team of CNN Digital, working closely with our partners in the content production side, as well as the programming side, to really make the product come to life. So that's basically it.
Not a small thing.
Not a small thing.
Given the impact, yes, it's a very high level. What is the impact in terms of how you find audience for people that consume CNN?
I mean, we have a really big audience, right? Our problem is less about finding audience and more about how we get that audience to engage with us, stay with us, spend time with us. We have built a site that reaches, over 130 million uniques on a monthly basis on average. And we have a pretty habitual audience that comes, but what we need to do is take that 130 million and really, how do we get those people to stick around? What are the kinds of tools and features that we need to build that can help our users understand the world better, spend time with us, learn information, and effectively keep people up to date on what's happening in the world today?
I can't wait to dive deeper into how you segment audience, how you think about success metrics, yeah, and make sure that the audience is engaged at CNN. I want to take a step back and learn more about your own journey and how you broke into product first and foremost, and then how you grew your career up to where you are today. So let's start from the very beginning. How do you end up in product?
It's a good question. I definitely do not have a traditional product background. My journey really begins with just a love for journalism. I joke that I, was the editor of my high school newspaper, and pretty much since I graduated college, have been working with journalists or in media companies my entire career. So it really stems from a love of journalism. And over time, as I started to be involved, not as a journalist, but on the kind of business side of journalism, more and more there was a need for at the time, which wasn't really called product, but now looking back, basically was the start of what product would become, was this need to think about, okay, how can we think about our readers more and our users more to drive forward the business as, you know, ensure that sort of journalists can stay in business, right? So much has happened to media companies in my career, you know, with just the internet coming into light, the media companies have been, their business models have been threatened. And a lot of what I see myself as doing is like, how do we make these experiences that people want to spend time with? And then we're able to keep the journalism going. So my career really started like that, a love of journalism that led into different roles. Effectively, my first really major product job was when I was at the New York Times. I worked on the New York Times cooking app for 5 years and launched their paywall and scaled that product. And that was my first like really big product job. And you know, it was an amazing experience. It was such a pleasure. And then moving into CNN was sort of my next big step. And that's where I am here today.
So obviously having domain expertise and passion is key, but in general, becoming a product manager requires others set up. And for someone who doesn't come from the traditional like technical background, how were you able to get that first shot at working with engineers and other professionals?
I mean, a little bit of right place, right time, not going to lie. When I was at the New York, so backing up a little bit, when I started in my career, I was more on the marketing side. So I really had like a marketing bent. And then I went to business school. And after business school, I got into organizations and I was doing like strategy and business development and some other things that really gave me an understanding of how does this all work together? And when I started at the New York Times, I was doing that. I was doing strategy. And so then after that, I was able to, I find myself in a position where someone basically took a bet on me to say, hey, Amanda kind of, she has an idea of the strategy here. We've got a really talented engineering team. I think if we put them together, we're really going to see great things happen. And that's effectively what happened. So yes, I did not have the like traditional, this is how Jira works. This is how you like do user stories. But I had a lot of people around me that really helped get me, you know, ramped up pretty quickly. And my focus was really about leadership and how do I empower the team to be effective? And that is really what kind of got, you know, how I got that experience that led me to here.
I think that's a great point for non-technical professionals to realize that there are so many different angles. And of course you need to be excellent at least at one of them, but you also need to learn fast enough to be able to collaborate with others.
Yeah. And I also find that like, honestly, not every product role is going to be the same at every company. Not even within the same job are you going to be working on projects that are exactly the same, at least in my industry, right? Where we're not creating widgets here. We're solving user problems that are complicated and require expertise from a lot of different places. And they're unique and maybe never been done before and certainly have never been done before with the exact people you're working with, right? So I think that I take a very generalist approach to product management, more of a general management approach to product management. Like everything is my business and my role, I feel, because that holistic thinking really makes you a better product manager. And you, while technical skills are really important, and you know, definitely should be something if you have them, you need to tout. But I think that you can kind of learn almost anything if you are smart, curious, willing, and really have a great attitude about doing that. So I think there's a lot of ways to get into product management and there's a lot of different jobs for that.
We're working in it and we've seen so much success from different professionals, of course, technical, non-technical, and many others. And I think having role models like yourself on stage, sharing the story about how you actually did it, is great for that next generation of product leaders.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, now that you are in the position of growing your own team, I'd love to learn more about your principles for hiring and growing product talent.
Yeah. So, you know, the thing about product principles, you know, they're not static, right? So the product principles that actually we've developed are always an evolving thing for us, especially now. We have a new CEO, Mark Thompson, who I worked with at the New York Times. We have an evolving strategy here at CNN. And so we're actually in the middle of like redefining a lot of these principles, but the principles will probably still be around the same thing. So one of the ones I think about a lot here is trust. Trust is such a huge part of our brand at CNN. It's imperative that the general public trusts the reporting that we put out. And that applies also in the products. Like, we need to reflect and reinforce the high level of trust that we have as a brand in the experiences that we have. So we have to ensure that we can have a site and a product that performs, that's able to do what it needs to do. So trust is a big part of the product principles. Other things are around empowering our journalism and our journalists. Yes, we think about the end user, but we also think about our users, our journalists as well. We want our journalists to be able to do their jobs, write their stories, put their videos online in the way that is easy for them. We don't want them to have to think hard about what they need to do to get the story out there. It should be seamless. It should be intuitive. So we really think about how do we empower the journalism. And then three is, we really see our brand as we're for everyone, right? This is CNN. You come to us for breaking news, for world-class video, for interactive storytelling, and we are really for everybody. And so that means we need to have an accessible, efficient experience when you come to us. We want to be inclusive in how we think about design. And so that is a huge principle. And then at the end of the day, obviously, everyone says users first, but I think what we mean here is we put our viewers and our readers first in everything that we do. So how do we think about the user experience if I am sitting on the couch, if I am commuting? What do we want people to be able to, how are people interacting with the news, and how can we make that best experience for them? So those are some of the baseline principles. Obviously, as I said, those are going to evolve as we start to get a new vision, a new strategy over time. But at the end of the day, those are kind of like, I would say, core to how we think about product.
And when you are interviewing people for your team, what are some ways for you to screen for that alignment in principles, as well as any other skills that are relevant for people to be successful?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the fun thing about working in media is you kind of get lots of different people with lots of different backgrounds. We don't have a necessarily like you have to have a CS degree, or you have to have this on your GMATs or SATs or whatever, however they do it at some of the Big Ten companies. But what we screen for, I think, is more around, I would say, collaboration and ability to kind of be flexible in an environment that's rapidly shifting. It's no secret that the media industry is rapidly changing. Every single day is very different. Not only is the news obviously very different every single day, but just like the business we're in is rapidly shifting. And so we need product managers who can kind of come in for certain jobs, but have like that flexible nature where their jobs may shift over time, because that's kind of the organization we're in right now. Also, collaboration is critical. You're basically coming in and teaching an organization what product management is. And so you have to go and work with journalists who literally don't know what the word product management means. I mean, I sit in meetings all day where people have their own ideas of what they think product is. And you kind of have to show them what it is. And part of showing them what that is it's not just selling yourself, but I think it's showing how you think come out from a user first perspective. Even in a big media company, you need to come at it from it's the customer, it's the user. And it's pretty intuitive for a journalist because they're probably thinking about that too. But I think it's helpful for you to come in with that discipline and show how you can be collaborative and work together to really solve those problems.
Yeah, well, let's do that exercise here. And you.
Oh, great.
I'd love to break down.
Here we go.
At CNN, I heard you talk a little bit at the beginning. I also heard you talk about how the journalist is a user for you, and you're building products, internal products for them to be more effective at their work. So how do you break down your products?
You mean like the organization or like the actual experience?
Yeah, let's talk about like the different products that you have, and then we can talk about like how you are structuring the org to support those.
Yeah.
Products.
So Yeah. So the products we have, right, the biggest one is obviously CNN.com, both our website, our mobile website, right? And these are, you know, it's a news website, but also has a massive video component, right? So you are able to watch CNN on these devices in this platform. And so being able to, deliver video, deliver the video that you see on television on these platforms, as well as deliver different video for different users, is a big part of what we do. So the way that we think about our team is we have a reader experience team that's really focused on, okay, the article templates, the interactive stories that you might see. And then we have a video and audio team that really focuses on the video experience in particular across all these platforms and the audio experience across all these platforms. And so designing it like that allows for subject matter expertise in some of these specific ways that people consume content, and they can really come at it from a user perspective. We also have a platforms team, and that platforms team is really focused on the CMS as well as the sort of underlying technology of the site, because those two are connected. And so that CMS team is putting themselves in the minds of the journalists and saying, hey, I'm a programmer, I'm a journalist, I need to get my story up online in X amount of time. How do we make the best possible tools for that? So we have a whole team that focuses just on that. And then I'd say the last piece, which is still like a nascent thing for us, is really thinking about revenue and growth in a bigger way and a more user-centered way than perhaps we have in the past. So that comes in the form of how do we build the right habit loops back to the product that can help drive whether it's active users or drive additional page views that really help our business. And then how can we think about making our ad experience as good as it possibly can? We are an ad-driven company. We need to make sure our ads are not totally assaulting our users all the time. But we believe there's a way to do this and still provide a premium ad experience that doesn't deter the user, but also helps us ensure that we are feeding the business. So we really think about all of it. Like, we've got our users, we've got our journalists, but we also have to think about our ad partners as well.
And what about these other formats, for example, audio or TV, like connecting to smart TVs? Like, is that part of your product umbrella as well?
Absolutely. Yeah. So all of our audio, so to be super clear, we have production teams who are producing the news all the time and producing the podcasts all the time. And so that's their job. They're creating the content. We are the ones who are saying, okay, we've got the feed or we've got the actual technology and like making it available to our users in many different ways, right? So from an audio perspective, yes, of course, we have podcasts that go out on, you know, Apple, Spotify, et cetera. We have your ability to listen to those podcasts within our web environment. And then for video, same thing. You can watch. It's about how do we make that video accessible to as many people as possible on as many platforms as we can. So on our website, on our mobile app, you can watch video. You can not only watch the video that you see on TV, but you can also see videos that we clip and in order to help explain some of the stories that we're also publishing. And then the smart TVs is a huge piece of it as well, right? We have a number of folks who access our video content on smart devices, and that continues to grow, and we continue to expand support for different devices depending on how quickly we can move.
I love that. I think it's such a refreshing perspective for PMs to realize that this is not about a website or a mobile app anymore. There are so many different channels. Yes. And like there is the key to maintain the consistency of the brand and the trust across wherever you are serving your customer. Because in many cases, I guess the customer is switching channels.
Totally. They might be watching TV on their mobile app. They more likely than not, they're not on TV and they're just on their mobile app. But even in their mobile app, they might be switching between different ways of consuming that content. I also think it's important to know we have we distribute a lot of our content to a lot of third parties. So even just the idea of how we will create data feeds that go to another party that licenses our content, right? So we have a lot of different business models that we have to support in order to as you point, like get our brands into different places. And so making sure we have a consistency of that and that it's all kind of feeding from the same place is really critical.
And in terms of internal products, you know, the tools to enable journalists and other people, how do you structure that?
Yeah, so we have, essentially we own the CMS for our entire, our digital journalists, right? So we have one team that thinks about the editorial experience. So I literally like, how do I write my story in this tool that then publishes it on the site? And then we have a programming experience as well. So how do I think about what order the stories go into? And so what we're able to, our tool allows both of those teams to be able to do their jobs. We, in all honesty, we literally in the past 6 months, it's been one of our biggest priorities is getting those teams onto this new CMS. So we have, are finally finishing that work, which, as you know, as a product person, a big replatforming is no small achievement. And we have to onboard a lot of those teams. So our product people actually are training the journalists. And what's great about that is then you, it's very rare that I think in consumer products that you get to like sit down with the person like literally who needs to use this and actually take that feedback in real time. And they're your coworker, right? So there's this really great feedback loop that happens between our journalists and our product folks to say, okay, this is working. This is not working. We need to change this. We need to update that. And I think that partnership has been really critical and making that a success.
And in product, I've seen sometimes PMs not wanting to work at internal products just because it seems to be less prestigious. Although I disagree, I think this is an amazing opportunity to actually treat your own team members as your customers and build technology for them to be much, much more efficient. On that note, one of the classic dilemmas for PMs is build versus buy. Like how much of that do you need to build in-house versus how much you can accelerate by integrating with a software, a third-party software? So what is, what's your philosophy around that?
I mean, it honestly depends on the thing, right? We talk about this a lot. I think for, and you know, I'm sure every PM or every product leader is going to have a different perspective on this, but my philosophy is like, if it's core to what you do, you probably have to build it because it has unique enough capabilities. Now, actually, our Stellar system is based on a technology that was built out of another company. I think it was New York Magazine, but the called Clay. And the person running Clay actually ended up coming here. And so we basically took this third-party technology and then made it our own, right? But I do think because telling stories is so critical to what we do, that is the kind of thing that you probably want to build. But there are other things where you're right. We probably shouldn't build. I would say like how we do segmentation, like user segmentation, that's probably not something that we want to build ourselves. We probably want to license a third party to help us with that. So I think it honestly, I know that's like a non-answer, like it depends, but it really is true. It is kind of, you know, it does really depend. But I think at the end of the day, if whatever you're doing is core, you should focus on building like to support that. Things that are not core, that's where I think you can really start thinking about licensing.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the parts that are make product management so unique depending on each company, because there's not a binary answer, right? Like there might be cases within your current company where you decide to build. There are other cases where you might decide to buy and anything in between.
Yeah, totally. And I mean, we were even thinking about that, even like within CNN, we have an entirely different technology team that focuses on the video production side. And we're even thinking internally, like, should our CMS be helping the video production, like the TV production side? Like, should we extend what our CMS can do? Or does it make more sense for them to go license a technology? So those questions are stuff we're asking ourselves all the time here.
I need to ask you the $1 million question about artificial intelligence. So
let's do it.
I'm very curious to know how you are thinking about the use of artificial intelligence for your product.
Yeah, I mean, what's really great is there's a lot of people thinking about that right now, especially in the content space, right? And there's no shortage of ideas. I think some of the areas that we're talking about, a lot of them are, there's kind of two different ways. Like the internal one, which is how can we use AI to help our staff internally do their jobs better? So things that we are interested in looking at are there ways that we can use AI to better search and bring forward our giant video archive, right? So our video archive is something that our employees internally, when we're thinking about stories now, hey, I need to go find that clip about that thing. That kind of ability to be able to parse through our archive in basically a moment's notice or through the couple keywords is really, really powerful. And that's something that's just one use case of an area that we see is really powerful. Another one is around, like, back to my concept on truth is that we think there's also a powerful use case where AI can help us determine whether we're seeing videos that are real or fake, and that we're not putting fake videos on our channels, right? Like, that is getting harder and harder to get right. And so AI can be a powerful way for us to think about, to ensure that we are able to make sure that we are not, you know, telling stories with wrong information, right? So that's another use case for AI. And then, of course, there's the user-facing AI. Like, how can we use AI to build better products for our users? And there's a myriad of things that I think we can do, ranging from, you know, our own AI assistants that you can sort of, if you have a question, we can pull up kind of where that information is within CNN. And we've been experimenting with ChatGPT-4 and in some of those places. It's exciting. It's new. I'm excited about it. I think the question is always going to be, how much do you invest in the new stuff versus sort of making sure you have the core stuff well? And it's not binary. You got to be kind of doing both at the same time. But we're excited about what it can bring for an organization like ours, for sure.
I mean, I definitely see a lot of potential in both internal and external use cases. What's coming to my mind is also, like, staying consistent with your principles of,
yeah,
staying true and, like, providing a good brand consistency, like the human touch, and, like, it's still going to be critical, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, you could even imagine, like, in the CMS conversation we were just having, like, could you use AI to almost pre-write some basic summary for, you know, with just a couple of words, right? We don't want to replace jobs with AI. I think for journalists, that I know is something folks are worried about, but I see it more as, like, how can they use AI to move faster, to do some of the heavy lifting on their research? And that's something that, you know, we want to explore in tandem with our journalist colleagues to build those products for them.
Another key topic is money. You mentioned that the product team is involved in creating the ads and the business of your company, make sure that it's striking the right balance between the content that is free and available and not intrusive to your viewers. So first of all, how involved, how accountable is product for the overall revenue of the company?
That's a good question. In all honesty, like, we are not responsible, obviously, for the ad sales, right? Like, our accountability is much more on engagement and enabling the revenue numbers. That's something we're working on, though, is, like, how do we want to think about how product work drives the bottom line? But at the end of the day, we don't have revenue responsibility, but we do a lot of work to support revenue, both in, like, you know, engagement equaling revenue, as well as, you know, just the ad experience itself, making that a better experience for our marketers. So we work very closely with our sales team on that approach. What do we need to be doing to make sure that we build products that are the ad products that have users in mind, and that we're able to scale a lot of those ad products for our marketers.
And I remember at the very beginning of the interview when you mentioned that, yes, there's a big audience, but at the same time, you are really interested in the engagement of that audience, yeah, and the segmentation, yeah, of that audience. So what are some of those success metrics for you?
Yeah, it's fun. What's fun about this conversation is like, we are in the process of, like, starting to really put some discipline against that. As you know, that's part of the challenge, is, like, how do we make sure the whole organization is thinking about this in the right way? So the team has been thinking about, like, what is our measurement framework, so to speak? Like, how do we think about the funnel? So from our perspective and product, you know, you have your top of the funnel, which is hugely important. And yes, we don't have a top of the funnel problem because we have such a big audience, but we want to make sure that it's healthy, it's consistent, that we're still able to, you know, keep that scale. I'd say the second level is around repeat visitors and then like active users, right? So our repeat visitors are the folks coming back 1, 2, 3 times in a month. And then our active users are those coming back 4 times in like a 7-day window. So we really want to think about how, like creating that habit. How are we getting users to come back more frequently? And then also, how are we getting them to spend more time with us? Where we know that if we can get users to spend a lot of time with us, they're much more likely to come back. So we think about how are these things correlated? But so time spent and sort of repeat visits in a small window are the really key metrics that we ladder all of the thinking against. Obviously, those numbers don't move quarter to quarter. We're looking at those are big metrics that take years sometimes to see differences on. So it's all about, okay, how do we break those down into like to the right level of detail so that teams can then act on those metrics, right? If you give a product team, hey, go increase active users for a quarter, they frankly won't ever get there because it's also for us so news driven, right? Like if we have a big story in the news, that's probably what's going to drive it. So you have to break it down. Like what are the things that are actually going to move that? And so it might be, hey, how can we get more people to sign up for push notifications? Or how can we get someone to their next click on an article page? Those are the ways that we take those big metrics, those North Stars, and then really down into the project level, think about how we move the needle small. And then hopefully over time, those will have a bigger impact on those bigger metrics over time.
Mm-hmm. And then one strategic decision that I guess as a product leader you have to make is also how to design your org to support those metrics. And I've seen different approaches, right? Like different teams that focus on different stages of the life cycle. I've seen more of a cross-functional approach where PMs are in charge of multiple stages of that life cycle. So curious to know how you're thinking about it.
Yeah. So I would say the way I think about it is the teams I kind of mentioned, like a reader team and a video team. Both of those teams are what I would call like the engagement teams. They're really focused on like not about ad revenue or like optimizing for yield and not about SEO. Although like, obviously we want to build something that, you know, keeps a strong top of funnel. Their focus is like, how do we increase that middle bottom of funnel with our experience, making that experience as good as possible, getting users to spend time with us, creating a product that is simple, clean, easy for people to get their information. So it's really those two teams that I would call like the engagement teams. And then I have that growth revenue team that's thinking about, okay, how do we get more direct relationships with our users so then we can drive engagement, right? So their metrics are much more like registered users or ad yield, right? Like how do I make our performance, right? Like how do I make the ads more performant or how do I improve the sell-through rate of that unit, right? So those are very like monetizing metrics, if you will. And then the platform team is obviously measured on a very different scale around performance, around how many people are using our CMS and they have a different kind of set of metrics that you know, we have for those journalists. Like, are they speed to publishing? You know, how many people in the organization are using it? How many people are onboarding? Those kinds of metrics that we use to measure that. But so it's primarily like, I would say like engagement and then revenue and growth are like really the bottom of the way, like enablers of that engagement. And then we have the sort of performance piece.
Amanda, I really loved our conversation. Thank you for the opportunity to learn more about how product is made at CNN and how you're thinking about growing your own org. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you so much. Really appreciate it.